first thing. So everything from this unit is on term two. So everything in this unit is term two. Any extra credit you earn during this, like today, Thursday, Monday, Wednesday, you can count either way. So at the end of the period, I am going to try and save time to come around and pay you the one full ticket if you are focused on time, not on your cell phone, not talking when we're discussing. One full ticket if you are participating throughout the class period. And then extra tickets for every little point you get. And then a reminder, just to make it so I don't have to say the word point so often, if you raise your hand and I call on you by name, just mark that down as a point. It doesn't matter if you have a question or an answer, it counts either way. So those can count for term one or term two. The homework, though, quizzes, whatever, from this day forward is all term two. You with me? Awesome. Okay, somebody asked last period, what do they do with their term one stuff? My advice is take it out of your binder. I wouldn't keep carrying it. It just makes the binder too cumbersome because I give you a lot. Just take it out of your binder, put it in a box at home so you have it in case you need it for something. Once in a while, you may say, wait a minute, I got to look up this problem I worked on. Just put it somewhere in case. Most people don't go back and look, but just in case. So. Oh, please.
Would you say
the flashcards I would keep with you. What's going to happen, Paris, is unit two is like the only standalone unit we do during the year. What I mean by standalone is it's like an old-fashioned math unit. It's very step-by-step. It's very follow the rules. It's not really concept-based per se. It's more just like step one, step two, step three. So it's typically everyone's favorite unit. You're like, all right, I just relax and just do steps. But unit three is where we combine what you learned from unit one with unit two. This is where we are preparing. Okay. This should not be a thing. I continue to surprise you in ways that I don't think I should surprise you. You're preparing for the AP Calculus test. The AP Calculus test, see, honestly, the good thing about calculus is it's not six independent units that don't relate to each other in any way, shape, or form. No, we learned limits. One, because they do have several questions on the AP test just on limits. But the second reason we learned limits is so that what we talk about in this unit makes some sense. We learned about f prime, f double prime, so what we talk about in this unit connects to that. In unit three, we just put it all together. Okay, so I would keep the flashcard for sure. Other questions? And honestly, Paris, I would keep going through them. Because even though in unit two you're not going to need those flashcards, in unit three you will. So if you're checking your flashcards, you know, regularly, then you're going to be all set for unit three. This is a good beginning. It's perfect. Other comments? Perfect. Okay, so I've given you a couple of key things here. You want to get the green sheet out in front of you. This one here, like MJ. You'll need this. You have to have these memorized. It's easier to memorize them once you start using them. So I wouldn't just try to memorize it all coldly. What I would do is, like today, we're going to use several of these rules. That's your clue to, oh, I need to get those memorized. Then the next day we use several more. Oh, it's your clue to get those memorized. And say it strong enough. If you wait until the night before the test to memorize them, you're done. Like, you're just going to be back and you're doing the retake thing again. Okay? You must. Okay, follow the fine example of Blakely. Study properly the first time. Then she's like home taking a nap and just relaxing. Okay, listen, don't wait to memorize them. As soon as you're using them in your homework, start memorizing them. I'll give you the way I memorize them. I'll just demonstrate. And to me, it's the best way to do it. So anyway, we're going to use that. What else can I tell you? The homework tonight will not be all of these, right? The homework will be selected problems. I'm going to text out during third period the specific problems that you are to do from this sheet. Understand? Okay. So don't worry about the yeah, just look for the text. I got this from somebody. Thank you. Next thing. Look out. Come on. Okay. Learning this skill. Let me explain what we're doing. Okay, we talked about how a function, in fact, I want everybody to get a point on this, so raise your hand if you know the answer. On day two, I told you that if you have a formula, let's write one down here. In fact, we'll just use the first one on this sheet right here. So if you have a formula that says f of x, heck, this is y on this one, so let's use y. Y is equal to parentheses, negative 3x to the 4th. I believe it says plus 4, is that correct? To the third power.
Yes.
Good. Okay, that's a formula. Raise your hand, I'll pay you. Everyone can get this point. Tell me, we learned this on day two. What's one of the main reasons for this formula existing? What's one of its main purposes? All of you know. Come on. You learned this on day two. I gave you quizzes on it. Can't forget it. What's one of the main purposes of this formula? Why do we have it? Why does it exist? So all of you are going to get paid on this one. So, Stephen?
Okay.
Hold on. Time to pay. Pay both people this time. I'm getting tired of calling the wrong name there. Sweet. Okay.
It's like the compute, like the values of the function.
Yes. A function is nothing more than a list. You know, one simple definition of a function is list of x, y pairs. The purpose of the formula is to find the x, y pairs. Plug in the x, you find the y. I mean, knew it before you said it. Point? So think of it this way. You've got x, and we'll just think of this as being f of x. Okay, this is just a list of x, y pairs. Here. This is just a list of x, y pairs as well. It's just another function. But hands up, all who know, come on. What do these x, y pairs have to do with these x, y pairs? Hands up. Gotta know it. The quick answer was perfect. You gotta know this quickly. Perfect. So every one of these values here is a tangent slope of this function at the same x coordinates. I mean, you know it before she said it? Or you?
Oh, please. Yes. With just me thinking that it's the prime of it, still be like the tangent.
It's totally fine to think of it as the prime of that. Just you can't forget that what prime means is, oh, it's
tangent.
The derivative, oh, it's the tangent slope, oh, it's the instantaneous rate of change. All those meanings are important. So, flashcards again. So I've got, well, I've got 12,000 flashcards on order, so. Okay, I'm serious. You guys laugh, like they're coming. All right. not kidding, they're being shipped, so 12,000. I know what you guys are running at. There's nothing more important than the flashcards. Since the cold sore here is starting to bother me, but. Okay, focus. I will try to focus myself. So f prime, list of x, y pairs, but every one of these y values is a tangent slope of this. Got it? Okay. We have a formula for computing all of these x, y pairs. The goal of unit 2 is to find a way to, from this formula, create a formula for f prime. That's it. That's the entire goal of unit 2. There's nothing else that we do for the entire unit. We just say, hey, how do you take this formula and from this create a formula for f prime? Oh, here's another example. How would you take this formula and create a formula for f prime? That's all we're doing. But it's essential that you keep track of what we're doing and not just learn the steps, okay? So does anyone have a question about what we are doing? Like the goal of unit 2. One other thing to warn, oh, please, go ahead. In fact, the more that different people say that one, the better it will help everyone else. So I'll pay 3 points for someone to raise their hand and just state, what's the goal of unit 2?
Unit 2 is a formula for f, and
do you take this formula, this equation for f, and create another equation that's going to be for f prime? That's the goal of unit two. Anybody else have a different way of saying it? 3 points for Kenneth, please.
You can just say you're trying to find the equation.
Yeah, you're trying to find the equation of the derivative. I write these words down. This is the language. It's important to know the language so you don't get lost on the entrance test. What we're doing is we are going to differentiate, which means to find the derivative. So we're going to differentiate f of x to find, create, make, whatever you want to call it, to find f prime of x. That's what we're doing. That's unit two. And there's nothing else that we do in unit two. Unit two goes really fast. Unit one went from August 22nd-ish, can't remember exactly, to October 4th. We'll take the test for unit two end of October. And it's already October 10th. So much faster, about half as long. Okay. All right. So now I know what we're trying to accomplish. Let's show you how you do that. So turn the page here. Let's go back this way, read that one. Okay. So the function we're dealing with in this example is y equals negative 3 x to the 4th plus 4 all cubed. Okay, at this point, it is critical that you write exactly what I write on the board. Look at me. Do not invent your own math language. Half of the points you earn on the AP test come from the written section. It's like trying to take the AP Lit test or the AP Language test or the AP US History test, and in the written portions where you're writing an essay or something, you're like, well, I kind of like my own grammar. So I just use mine.
Oh, no.
Oh boy, is the right answer. Kesta knows she takes college classes. The professor goes, what are you thinking?
My professor is the worst for bio, though. Like, you won't put the information you learn in the lecture in the quiz, so you really have to, like, be knowing what he's thinking reading into this.
That's hard. Anyway, no worries. Hey, write what I write. I'm not kidding. Write what I write. Okay, I'm going to show you step by step. This is a step by step unit. The last unit was like, oh, I remember this, and I'd write something, and I'd write something over here, and then I'm going to put it together, and your guys are like, what's he doing? This one is step one, step two, step three. Okay? As we progress through the unit, I will give you, how should you say, guidance as to when you can write less. But if you start writing less too soon, you will be messed up for the test. I guarantee it. You will be messed up. If you follow my example, you will be just fine. Okay? Questions? Awesome. So, first step. Over here on the right, just write this. D over dx. Okay? This is a mathematical operator. Think of it as like sine or cosine. Those are mathematical operators as well. They do something to whatever you're operating on, okay? This is a mathematical operator. That's the operator we're learning today. It's the derivative operator. Okay, I want everyone to raise their hand and answer this. This is a simple question, so if it feels way too simple, just raise your hand if it means you know the answer. If I have an equation like this, and I, for some reason, need to multiply this side of the equation by, say, 10, if I want to maintain the equality of the equation, what must I also do? Enzo. I told you, it seems simple, and you got it. Bailey?
Multiply
both sides by 10. So if I multiply the left by 10, I must multiply the right by 10. Everybody good?
Yes.
Okay, the same is true if you're using the derivative operator. If I apply this operator, it's called taking the derivative or differentiating. If I differentiate this side of the equation by writing down, so please write this down. I write d over dx. I want it to operate on this. y. Okay, I'm applying the derivative operator to the left side of the equation to keep the balance of the equation, to keep it equal. I must apply the operator to the right.
So you go like this, d over dx. Now please remember, d doesn't mean derivative. D means difference, infinitesimal difference. This ratio is derivative. So this is the derivative of y is equal to the derivative of this thing. So I apply the operator. Questions? Anyone want to talk about anything? Awesome. Okay. Next thing. It's a little bit cumbersome to write the d over dx parentheses y. So you need to recognize that this symbol means exactly the same as this symbol. They mean exactly the same thing. But I would keep writing it this way for a while to get used to the idea that they mean the same thing. If in your homework you always do what I'm doing here, you won't ever forget that those are the same. And they won't trick you on an AP question where they just happen to write it this way. I've seen it happen. People are like, I didn't know what they wanted. Like, they wanted this. Oh, I didn't know that. That's because you stopped writing it like I told you to. So. Questions? Sorry to be a little bit arrogant there. We good? Sweet. Next slide, put equal. Don't forget the equal sign. Okay. Now what we have to do is we have to use the green sheet. So I'm going to erase this just so I have a little more room on my paper because I kind of run out of room on the board. So you look at the goal at the green sheet, and where you're looking, let me put it out in front of me here, you're looking down the left side of the green sheet. So you're looking down this side here. Don't look at the right, just the left. So everyone, I want you doing it. Look at the, oh wait, we gotta write one more thing here. Sorry, my bad. Go back to your sheet here, and this can also be written like this. You just have to memorize that these are the same. This could be d over dx. This could be d of negative 3x to the 4th plus 4 cubed all over dx. So in the same way that we said this can be written more compactly like this, same thing here. This can be written like this. They're the same thing. You want to comment on that? Okay. Now it's time to look at the green sheet. So you look at the left side on the green sheet. Like you look straight down, all of these on the left. What I mean by the left is the left of each equation. So looking here, let's go back to the board so I can point better. So right here, I'm looking at this versus this versus this versus this. Versus this. I'm not looking at this or this. That's what I mean by the left. I'm sorry. So it's both columns, but only the left of each equation. Does that make more sense? Okay. You look at it. Look at this sheet. Find on this sheet one of these things. This one, or this one, or this one, or this one, etc. That matches what you see here. That. It's a pattern. To help you with the pattern, notice this. The parentheses on this sheet simply mean that it's some expression. So it could be anything. Some expression to some exponent. This one here is saying you have d dx of e, special number, you know, 2.7, to some expression. This one is d dx of the natural log of some expression. Okay? You're trying to find the match for our particular example. So we want what rule matches this format. I'm up to everyone who tries on this one. So even if you're wrong, if your hand is raised, you get the point. So which one do you think matches? There's how many on the sheet? 14 of them? Yeah, 14 of them. No, there's 16. Yep, 16 of them. Which of the 16 matches this format?
This is how unit two works, the whole unit. Find the rule. You just have to get the rules memorized. Kinsey. Kinsey says the power rule. So over here on the side, I'm going to write down the power rule. Okay, eyes up here. I want to see your eyes over here. Look at me. You want a really good way to memorize the whole green sheet? Every single time you need to use a rule, try to remember it. And just write down the rule from memory. So here I go. I think, okay, I need the power rule. So I think it's d of, let's see, something to a number over dx. It's going to be n multiplied by the something, 1 minus 1, derivative of that something. As soon as I write down the rule, I would look at my green sheet and verify that I have written it correctly. That's how you memorize the rules. Okay, so it's fine at the beginning to use the green sheet to find the rule. As soon as you find it, turn it over. From memory, write it down. Then check your memory. That way you just slowly but surely migrate away from the green sheet. That's a, honestly, superb way to get it memorized. So, this is it. Thank you. Questions? Please.
So, the N and the parentheses are consistent throughout that whole thing, right? Like, if you plug in values that they were consistent.
Yes. Yeah, listen to Nate, please. Hey, my notation is not math textbook standard. It's a notation that I invented that students really gravitated to. They're like, oh, that's easier to understand. So I just use it to help you understand it. Like, you won't see it on the internet or anything, but it means what Nate said. It's d dx of some expression. So the parentheses represent the same expression in each case. So, other colors. Gossip.
N place. Some number.
Some number. Perfect. If this were to be an expression, I would put a set of parentheses to represent an expression. So this is like 5. They'll try to fool you sometimes. They'll put pi up here. Pi is a number. They'll put e up here. E is just a number. So, other comments? Oh, please, Karen.
So, since n is 3, then 3 would go in all the things.
Absolutely. It's perfect. Perfect. So you look over here, you're using the rule perfectly, Paris. I look here and say, hey, this matches with this. So Paris already noticed that the N is the 3, and the something, somebody commented, what's the something in this example? Okay.
-3x to the 4th plus 4.
Perfect, that's the something. -3x to the 4th plus 4. Anybody else want to talk about it? Please. Yeah, that's the way you read my rule. Okay? The way that they'll write it in a textbook is they'll say, instead of parentheses, Rachel, they'll say like f of x. And they'll put an f of x here and an f of x here. The symbols became a bit cumbersome for people just learning it. The parentheses seemed a little bit easier. So that's why it does. The meaning is the same. Anybody else? Cool. All right, next thing. The way we use the rules is we take advantage of what equal really means. Okay? Equal doesn't mean the answer is going to end up over here. Okay? Like in grade school, you did stuff like this where you say, classic, 2 plus 7, and then you said, oh, the answer is 9. Well, you didn't really mean the answer is 9. What you really meant is 2 plus 7 is exactly the same thing as 9. Like, you can write it like this. The equal doesn't mean we're pointing to the answer. Equal just means these two things are the same. Good on that? So back here, we use that according to the rule, the power rule. If you've got d dx of this, you can write this instead. So I'm going to. Instead of writing this, I'm going to replace what I'm circling with this piece here. So write it down. So on the next line you write, dy over dx, oops, wrong color,
say ydx equals, hey, make sure you write this sign. If you are not writing the equal sign, you're not doing math. You're just memorizing steps. This, we have to maintain equality, otherwise the problem falls apart. It doesn't make any sense. So this, oh, somebody tell me what to write. Like, use the rule, tell me what can I write this, like, what's the other form of this thing? Using the rule, awesome.
So I think it's the
this kind of thing?
Like, how on the rule it's, yeah, that one.
Oh, I'm not sure if I'm going to answer this. I'll try it. If it's wrong, you just keep talking, okay?
Okay.
Like, I'm not sure I'm going to be able to, I'm not sure what you're saying. It's not your fault, it's mine. But I'll do my best, and if it doesn't work, you just talk. What I did is I started with this equation, and what's the purpose of this equation, Paris?
XY
pairs of F. So we plug in an x and find a y. Good?
Uh-huh.
Okay, first thing I did is I took the derivative, or you can say I differentiated both sides of this equation, which means I apply the d over dx operator to both sides.
Yeah.
Now, big caution, everybody look at me. Come on. This doesn't mean multiplication at all. It's d over dx of y. They're not multiplying. The derivative operator operating on the y, okay? Same thing here, there's no multiplication here at all. It's the difference in y divided by the difference in x. The entire thing is called the derivative of y. But it goes back to what equal means. Because equal means these things are the same. Writing that the derivative of y is this symbol, which it is the same as saying, well, the derivative of y is the same as the derivative of this. Those two things are the same. I don't really do anything else with the left side of this equation, ever. I just carry it all the way down. Keep going.
So is the left part of that power rule, that's just to tell you which part of the right side to use?
Yes.
Okay,
let me say it back to you. So I don't do anything more with the left of this equation. I just leave it as dy dx. I now look at the right side of this equation, and I find a rule that fits. With me?
Yeah.
And the rule that I can, it's like left and right, and you're right. I find that in my list of rules, the left side of this rule fits this piece. Okay? With me? So I can operate, I can use this on this. I'm not doing anything over here at all. Like, I'm not comparing these two, I'm not.
Okay.
I'm comparing this one to this one.
Okay.
And then once I find the match, I say equal tells me that I can rewrite this another way, so then I wrote it this way.
Okay, yeah.
That's
right.
What you meant,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Perfect.
I understand the right side of it and how that applies, but I'm just confused with the left side of the equation because on the power rule, it says that there's a, n.
So are you trying to compare the left and right of this with the left and right of this?
The one below it.
The left and right of this?
Yeah.
So we're not doing that.
Oh.
Good question. Keep talking. I'm not doing anything with this left side.
Okay.
I'm saying that this piece, and everybody, eyes here, look. The fact that this is on the left has nothing, on the right has nothing to do with it. I could have written these the other way. It would still be the same process.
because equal means these are the same. So it's not the left and right that's important at all. But I'm going to change this piece. I'm not going to do anything to that. So I'm not saying these two compare to these two. I'm not doing that.
Okay.
I'm saying this fits this pattern. Therefore, this can be transformed into this.
Oh, so we're
going to
ignore the left side. We're not
going to
fix the dy over dx.
No, dy dx is as simple as we can write it.
Okay.
There's nothing we can do with the dy dx.
My thing was, like, on the power rule, it shows d to something, to a number, and you're not going to put that in on the left. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just using the rule right here. Oh, that's very good. Anybody else want to talk? Please.
I don't know. That's my... When I saw the dy dx, I was like, in my mind, I just say the derivative of y. So when I see that, I don't see it. The numbers that I have to plug in, I just think of it as it's saying the derivative of y is equal to whatever's on the other side. So I don't get it.
No, that's pretty good. And something that might help as well, think of this. Somebody answer that. Actually, everybody can answer this. Go back to the beginning. We're doing all these steps for a reason. What's the big reason? Like, what's our goal? Stated it when we hands up, show me hands. Everyone knows. Very funny. I just want everybody to know it. What's the goal? If you keep track of the goal, it makes more sense as well. So, Emily, what's the goal?
To find the equation for f prime.
Find the equation for f prime. You learned this in unit one. What's an equivalent symbol that means exactly the same thing as dy over df?
So, are we saying that the bottom one is what the one above it equals?
Oh, for sure, because okay. Equal means same.
Okay.
So this says dy dx is the same as this formula. Dy dx is the same as that formula. They're just equal all over the place.
Okay.
That's why you must maintain equality. They're the same. So whole class question. What's a symbol that means exactly the same thing as dy dx? Don't think very hard. You just had a test, and on that test you had to know that dy dx and this other symbol mean exactly the same thing. Don't overthink it. Think simple. We did it on a quiz. We learned it. You've had it on the test. As soon as I say it, you learned it. I knew that. But well, you won't see that. Sorry. Go, Aaron.
F prime.
Yes.
Yeah,
how many knew it before you said it? Point. Question. Very good. Okay. So f prime is this formula. We're trying to find a formula for f prime. The trouble is, if you plug in x now, we don't know how to deal with this derivative operator. That you can't plug in x into this. Are we looking at that? Like, don't forget that. You can't just go plugging x into here. We've got to keep using the rule sheet, the 16 different rules, to keep changing this into a new form, okay? So, we used that rule to get from this form to this form. Now, there's a pattern here. Look. The derivative operator in step one was operating on the entire expression. When we used the power rule, part of the final version of the f prime formula was found. This part right here. Notice there's no ddx anywhere. That means this isn't going to change. We just write it again. Don't do this. Like, I'll get a stick and eat them. I didn't say that. Okay, don't do this. Okay, you want to get a good score on the AP test. Don't go writing, that doesn't mean anything in math, okay? At least not in this case. Like, you must write that down again. Don't do that. Even worse, people don't write anything. Then suddenly it just shows up again. I'm like, where's it? Sorry. My blood pressure is already high enough. Okay. So, this is 3. Blue. So just write it again. 3 parentheses, negative 3x to the 4th, plus 4. No, you can write it as 2. And honestly, hey, everyone, I wrote 3 minus 1 just so everyone could see where the numbers are coming from. You don't have to. You can just write 2. It's fine. So, there you go. Awesome. Okay, this one here. Okay, it says ddx of this. So you go back to the green sheet again. And on the green sheet, you're looking right here. looking at all of these. Again, left and right doesn't really matter. You just got to look in the right place on the formula. Like, for example, look up. There's nothing wrong with writing this formula the other way. Equal, there's no left and right. Equal means these are the same. Okay? So you're looking on this side here for a rule that matches what we have in front of us. Matches this situation right here. Now, caution. The power rule fits because you have something to an exponent of 1. But when the power rule has an exponent of 1, we really don't use the power rule anymore. There's other rules that fit better. So just remember that. When the exponent's 1, power rule is not what we're going to use. Even though it does work. Well, it doesn't really work. It's kind of like it's a dead end. Like, you can use the rule. It's not illegal. You just don't get anywhere. You go in a circle. You apply the rule, and you just end up right back where you started. So it's a waste of time. But there is another rule that fits this pattern. Hands up if you can see it. If you're wrong, I'll still pay you. I just want everyone to try. Like, look at the sheet, find a rule that fits this pattern. Raise your hand when you see one. Let's go, Tessa. So Tessa saw the add rule, and if I write this wrong, Tessa, you correct me. So if I'm doing my homework, I say to myself, okay, I've got to memorize the add rule. So let's see if I can remember it. Okay, so it says that D, dx, let's see, f plus g, where the f and the g are just representing two different expressions. So there they are. Now that's going to equal, they said f prime plus g prime, but for now I think I'd rather use this one. D of f over dg. Not d over dx, sorry. Plus d of g over dx. You really can. I think for now I would do this though. It'll make better sense to you. Like, use this. Everybody hear that? The other part of the rule is going to show up later in the class. Go ahead, Dustin.
Well, I don't know if you're going to give it away for
Oh, this one here? Outstanding question. It's because there's no DDX operator operating on this. So there's no reason to do anything with it. The rules are just explaining how the DDX operator operates on things. So the DDX operator, the derivative operator, is operating only on this. So we're just trying to see how to rewrite this portion. That portion stays the same. The operator earlier created this, but there's no DDX, so you don't worry about it. Anybody else? Per. Okay, so using the add-subtract rule, I'm going to use a red parenthesis here because it is one of the mistakes that occurs most often on a test, and I just want to start right today saying you're never going to make this mistake. Like, you just are not, because I'm telling you right now, this has happened a lot in the past, so it's not going to happen this year at all. Okay. I'm serious. It's not going to happen. Like, just think, I'm serious, like, it's psychology. If I tell you it won't happen and you focus really hard, it won't happen. Look here, it will work, I promise. It's gonna work, okay, ready?
I believe.
Look, this says 3 multiplied by this, multiplied by all of this. You got it?
Yes.
Okay, remember the DDX doesn't mean multiply. So it's not DDX multiplied by this, it's DDX of this. But everything else is multiplication. This times this times this. Okay, by the add rule, the addition rule, this one thing is going to become 2.
That makes it so easy.
Right? One thing's going to become 2. But I've still got to multiply all of this by whatever this is. So I have to have that parenthesis. If I forget the parenthesis, all of this will only be multiplied by the first item. You with me?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So somebody tell me what to write inside the parentheses using the rule. Well, go ahead, Sue. And you said that perfectly, Sue. Plus, right?
Yeah, plus 3/4 over
I see the question. Should make that one red to emphasize that last parenthesis. Oh, great question, actually. So everyone answer this. This mistake that I said has happened in past years, it's never going to happen this year, is people forget the red parentheses. So raise your hand if you can explain. If I leave off the red parentheses, what's the problem? I'll pay everybody. Like, what's the mistake? If you forget the red parentheses, what's the error? Why is it different? I'll pay everyone who raises their hand. Eric. Right, you're saying this times this, but only times this. This would just be hanging off on the end by itself. That's wrong. These two things are equal. If all of this had to be multiplied by all of this, that still has to happen. And we knew that before she said it. Come on. We want to talk about that. But here, Dawson, great question. Because it's just ddx of one single item, you can put the parentheses or leave them off, either way is fine. Doesn't really matter. Anybody else? On the four here. He's saying, do I have to have parentheses there? You don't. Because it's just one item. So. No. Awesome. Next thing. So keep going down. So you just rewrite this part again. So we say, let's see, f prime of x is equal to, oh, plan on using a lot of paper this unit. I'm serious, you want to get a good score on the test, use a lot of paper. If you try to cram everything in into tiny spaces, you just don't learn it as well. I guarantee you. Just go straight down the page, just turn the page and keep going. Okay? Don't be like cramming it in and don't. Okay? Straight down the page. So here we go. Don't do the junior high thing where you like, never mind. Straight down the page. Okay, look. Hey. This goes, oh, please. Oh, you're a genius. Thank you. It's important. Let me sound the state before Laura pointed it out. Points for all of you as well. Here right here. I forgot. Somebody asked a really good question. I forgot who it was, so I feel bad about that, but. Somebody said, oh, it's Dawson. Notice that there's no ddx over here, so you just leave it alone. But there's a ddx operating on this, we gotta take care of that. There's a ddx operating on this, we gotta take care of it. And the problem is very cyclical. You see the pattern? Mm-hmm. We said ddx applies, no, look, it's cool, look. It is. What I mean by, okay, I'll be honest, right? If you say, when you're at home and you get to choose between go to the movie, stay home and do this, like I'm going to the movie, okay? I'm not, you know. Cool. So don't get me wrong. Anyway. But the point is this. If you see the pattern, then the rest of the unit is easier. So here's the pattern. ddx is operating on the entire expression for y, right? But the first use of the power rule basically took care of one part of finding the formula for f prime, this part. We're done with that. The next part had ddx operating only on this portion right here of f prime, just that stuff inside. You see it?
Yeah.
Then when we use the add subtract rule, we broke that apart. So now ddx is only operating on each piece of the stuff inside. That's how it always works. You work inside out. Outside in. Sorry, thank you. You go outside in. See what I'm doing?
Mm-hmm.
And you just keep doing that. And you don't really have to think of yourself doing it because you just keep applying the rules. But as you apply the rules, that's what they do. They work outside inward. Until we work on every little part of the original formula up here, you'll see that when we get done, ddx has operated on every bit of that. It's just how the rules work. Okay, this class, the goal of this class, you're not tested on how these formulas are created. That's not part of our class.
So this is one element that you can simply memorize and say, I don't need to know for our class where these come from. You don't. You just know how to use them. Okay? That's for another higher level math class, like the detailed analysis of where all this comes from. Or you can think of it as this way. On the AP test, they don't test you on that, so I'm not going to spend time helping you learn it. You're not going to be tested. Does that make sense? Okay. In college, they spend a bit of time showing you where these come from. And then honestly, they don't test you on it either. They just show you where they come from. So anyway, so I remember in my calculus class, I'm like, well, that's cool. And then I didn't understand anything, so I just kept using them. So anyway, I finally figured it out later. I'm talking too much. Okay, quiet. Look. I just get schizophrenia talking to myself. That's not hearing voices, that's schizophrenia. That happens too. Okay. I'm talking to myself, not you. Okay. We've got to use a rule here. Okay, now listen close. Listen close. Okay, one big hint. Look here. Okay, don't make this mistake. The power rule doesn't fit. Okay. Because the power rule says something to a number, right? Well, one of these things isn't being raised to an exponent. What's not being raised to an exponent? -3. So it doesn't fit. You can't use the power rule, but there's at least two other rules you could use. Find them. Come on, everybody find it. Raise your hand when you see it. You can find it. Look at the rules. You just find the one that fits the pattern. So Ken is looking here and she says, look, it's -3 multiplied by x to the 4. So raise your hand if you can see a rule that fits. Come on, come on, come on. Find a rule that fits. Okay, everybody who's raises their hand. Rachel. The product rule absolutely fits because, now look out, come on. You've got -3 multiplied by x to the 4. Two things being multiplied, the product rule matches. Does anyone want to talk about how they can or cannot see that the product rule matches? David.
Sorry, Chris, I'm patching it. I keep saying it a different way.
You're okay. So look at the rule right here. And what I see is right here, it says ddx of f times g. So in the problem you're looking at, the f is -3, and the g is x to the 4.
Okay.
What happens?
The raise by 4, though. Like, sorry, like,
what happens? So you've got this. You've got d over dx of -3, x to the 4. So this is G, this is F. Sorry, this is F, this is G. Oh. F times G, F times.
Yeah, but the product rule doesn't say anything about putting it to the power of 4, though.
Oh, it doesn't have to.
Oh,
the F can be anything. And
okay.
The G can be anything. So
okay.
The F is just whatever, and G is just, there's two things multiplied.
Okay,
they can be
okay.
Two of anything.
Okay.
Now, that's a good question. Anybody else? Awesome. Okay, look at me. The product rule works. However, it's harder to use the product rule in this example than to use this other rule right here. Because -3 is a constant value. It's not a variable, it's just always -3. So if it's a constant multiplied by something, same thing here that I just said to David, f of x can be anything, but if it's a constant multiplied by a function, use the constant rule. It's just easier. Question? So, oh, please, friends.
Okay, so is it a constant because it doesn't have an exponent?
No, it's a constant because it never has any other value than -3. It's just...
So it's a constant because it's not x?
The letter x doesn't matter, but it's just in the in the forms of a problem. The x here, remember where the x came from. It came from this formula, which meant we could plug in any x we want, 6, -2, -100, calculate a y for that x, right? So x can be all kinds of different values. But -3 never changes. It's just -3.
Okay.
That's why we refer to it as a constant. Be careful with this, though, Paris and everybody else. On the AP test, the letter A is typically used as a constant as well. The letter B, the letter C, the letter K. So even though they're not written down as -3, they are constant values. They're not they're like one number. They're not like a whole bunch of numbers. X represents a whole bunch of infinite different values.
So is the f of x in the constant rule, that's x to the fourth?
In our example. Perfect. So using the constant rule, I'll write it down. So again, you should do the same so you get the rules memorized. So I write over here on the side of my homework, let's see, d of c times some function, that's the same thing as pull out the c and leave the d dx of the function. And then I just look at the green sheet to verify they're right. So then as Paris said, c is negative 3, f of x is x to the 4th. So somebody else tell me exactly what to write here. I just want to replace this using a rule. And the rule we're using is the constant rule. Go, Rachel.
C negative 3 times
D
times x to the 4th over dx.
Perfect. And then we still have to do this piece here. So we'll write that. Point for Rachel. Okay, I deliberately made an error. You can find the error, raise your head, okay? Everybody can find it. I deliberately made a mistake. Raise your head if you can see the mistake. Seems like a really silly mistake, then you see it. What's the mistake, David? Nicely done. Somebody saw it before I did it? Correct, point. Questions? Hey, right here. I'd just like you to, pretty sure if you can answer this. Can I rewrite this as, let's see, those reduce, so that would be just dx cubed over d. Just raise your if you know whether that's valid or invalid. So I just say, this is dx cubed over d. Just raise your if you know whether that's valid or invalid and why. Like, I've taught you to know this, but I just want to see if you can recognize it. Can I rewrite this as dx cubed over d? Ethan, please.
Isn't that a 4? Do these 3?
Yeah, so I want to say these divide.
Say these divide.
Why not?
I don't know why, but I feel like we can.
Your feeling is right. Feeling is right. No, you're good, Ethan. 2 points for that. Your feeling is correct. Mark down 2. But we got to know why. Why am I not allowed to do that?
Is it because you're not multiplying them?
It's the constant.
I see them.
What?
It's not multiplication.
Okay, so repeat how you found that. Yeah.
It's not. Hey, it's not d times x to the 4th.
Yeah,
it means difference.
Yeah.
So it's d of x to the 4th.
Also, difference of x
over difference of x.
Yeah.
It's not yet. D of it's hard to say all that. The important thing to remember is it's not multiplication.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
It's different. Okay, it's different.
Okay.
So these don't divide. We will. I just haven't done it.
That's good.
Hey, Brianna.
Why did you write equation 1 as equation
2?
Why did you do a whole other equation with all your numbers?
Oh, here's why. No, it's pretty good. Because it doesn't seem like a whole lot happened, right? Here's why. Watch. Come on. You got to hurry just a little bit. Focus. Look up. Come on. This part doesn't change. The reason I had to do that, Brianne, is because now a different rule applies to this. Sam, what rule applies to this? I've already used this rule. You've got ddx of something to a number.
Power
rule.
So, which makes it another d that looks harder.
So I got the parenthesis here. We can go back to the blue. Negative 3. Hey, come on. So using the power rule, somebody tell me how to rewrite this. Use the rule. Polly's got it. You do. Polly, it's easier than you're making it. Like, I'll help. Why? I've got d over dx of x to the 4th. So I just look at the rule I wrote down. Now, hey, this is golden. If you recall this from memory, then use it while you're doing the task. It's just you've got to be able to recall it from memory. So, looking at the two situations here, what's the something that's being raised to an exponent in this case? It's x. What's the exponent? So all you do is put a 4 here, put an x there, put a 4 there, put an x there. That's all you do. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Awesome. Tell me what you're right. I got to have a parenthesis here because it has to be multiplication. So I got 4. Nicely done. And then we got the plus d of 4 still.
Wow.
Yeah, they got to have another parenthesis right there. Please do.
Did we already use that? The constant rule?
Yep, right here. To get from this line to this line, this became, that was the constant rule. No, the red was just to emphasize. So. Yeah, I just did that so you could see that those are things people are pretty good. Please, Laura. No one talk. Nicely done. Because I can't say that x divides by x. That doesn't work. But dx is the same thing as dx. And this really does mean divide. So something divided by itself is 1. Okay, warning though, look at me. Hey. Until I tell you not to, Laura and everybody else, make sure you always write dx over dx. Okay. There's a really important reason I'm going to make you do that. When I get to the point where I can tell you why you did it, you'll say, oh, that does help. So just trust me. Just write dx, dx. It feels a little bit kind of extra, but just do it. Everybody else? Awesome. Hey, we're almost done. Look, there's no ddx anywhere now except for right there. Because as Laura said, this is 1. And 1 times whatever 1 is multiplied by is just the other stuff. Oh, you see what I mean? We've got one last thing to do. Look, you know, I'll text out the problems you'll do for homework. Listen, I hate busy work, but this is a bit of a repetitive process to learn this. So if you feel like you're doing the same problems over and over again, it's because I've just got to get you to get them right. Listen, okay, there's no rule for this one. Focus. There's no rule for this one because there's a different way of thinking about it. Okay, this means the derivative of the function 4. Well, that means the derivative of a function whose y value is always 4. What does a function look like if the y value is always 4? Straight line, horizontal. So we're trying to find the derivative of that function in this little part right here. Well, derivative means tangent slope. What's the tangent slope of this function?
Zero.
So what's this derivative?
Zero.
So the derivative of a constant is always 0. And then, Laura, look it up yourself. What's something added to 0? No, this is
something.
The something.
Oh,
so stuff plus 0 is just stuff. There we go. So I'm going to love the math term. It's awesome. So here we got the final result. We have found a formula for f prime. We got 3, negative 3x to the 4th, plus 4 squared. These two can multiply now. That's negative 12. I don't need parentheses around that x. That's 1, that's plus 0. Questions to there? And the last thing they did to make the answer match Bailey's checker, that's smart, the answer on the back, is they said, hey, these things that are being multiplied can be multiplied in any order that you choose. So the order they chose was the this times 12, negative 36. They wrote the x cubed over here because it's just multiplication. This is a formula. You can plug in any x, and it will find the tangent slope of the f function at that x coordinate. That's exactly how the graphs were created in all of unit 1. Like anytime they give you a graph for f prime, that's what they were doing. And that's what we're learning to do in unit 2.
That's
I gotta hurry. So you tell me, 1, 2, 3, or 4 tickets. So 1 for focus, 1 for participation, and then extra tickets for points that add up to 10. So, and I'll text you out the homework. Just make sure in the homework you work on separate paper and you go straight down the paper. Just follow the example.
Actually,
follow the example. You did number 1.
Good job, Howard.